Why don't Venus and Mercury have moons? Spinning around our sun are 9 planets, more than 120 moons, millions of asteroids and other rocky objects, and countless comets. Together, they make up the solar system, our home in this vast universe. Closest to the sun lies Mercury, followed by Venus, Earth, and Mars. These planets are known as the inner planets of our solar system. All the planets in our solar system are unique in an unusual way, and each of them has a notable characteristic feature unique to them. The Earth sustains life to grow, while Venus receives rain of extremely corrosive sulfuric acid. All planets in our solar system are surrounded by their mini-planets, or better to say, their satellites, which revolve around them in certain fixed orbits. The orbits can be distinguished and recognized by using Kepler's laws of motion. The Moon is the closest celestial body to the Earth. It is Earth's only natural satellite. Most satellites are much smaller than their parent planet. Earth is only one satellite. Mars has 2 satellites, and Jupiter has about 80 of them, including the largest satellite in our solar system, Ganymede. Saturn has more than 82 moons. Uranus has 27 satellites, while Neptune has about 14 of them. Even our dwarf neighbor Pluto has 5 satellites revolving around it. However, the first 2 planets of our solar system, Mercury and Venus, surprisingly do not possess moons. But why? Why are only the first 2 planets exception to this characteristic feature? And how exactly were the satellites formed? In this video, we will have a detailed study of satellites and the factors affecting the formation of satellites. Before we continue, make sure you like, subscribe to our channel, and hit the bell icon for further engrossing topics like these. What are satellites? Before we move on, let's discuss what exactly are satellites and how are satellites formed. Spoiler alert, all of our answers lie in the formation of the solar system and the aftermath of the solar system's formation. Satellites are celestial bodies that revolve around a much larger celestial body than them, usually a planet or dwarf planet. However, they can also orbit large, massive astronomical bodies such as large asteroid chunks and planets. In scientific terms, any celestial body that has a mass of about 1,000 times that of its parent planet and has an identified orbit around it can be termed to be a satellite. Don't confuse these satellites with the one Elon Musk and others are launching into space to help with your Wi-Fi. Those satellites are way different from the one in our discussion. How are satellites formed? Basic ways: giant impact and capture theory. The formation of these satellites is a byproduct of the formation of planets. It can occur in mainly 4 ways, although many other ways are still undiscovered. We might discover more ways of their formation someday. Satellite formation can occur through the giant impact, which is the collision of 2 or more large celestial bodies. The most famous example that you may have heard of is that of our Moon. Many theories are predicting the formation of our Moon, although the most suitable theory describes the formation of the Moon as a byproduct of collision between Earth and another Mars-sized planet, ejecting matter in space which came together under influence of their gravity, hence forming our Moon. Well, we'll come to our Moon's formation theories later in this video, as it is a whole new topic in itself. Another theory describing satellite formation is known as the capture theory. This theory was proposed by an American astronomer, Thomas Jefferson, who at that time was studying the Moon formation theories. This theory describes the capture of tiny planetary satellite-seeming objects, which were formed elsewhere by large planets. Most of these satellites are irregularly shaped objects, as they don't have enough mass to sustain a spherical shape. Phoebe, a moon of Saturn, is believed to have been captured by Saturn under some circumstances. How are satellites formed? Other ways: condensation and fission theory. Another theory explaining satellite formation is the fission theory, or as we may say, the wear and tear theory. During the early stage of planet formation, that is when the planet still existed in a molten state, if the planet rotates at a very high angular velocity, there is a high possibility that a part of the planet may be ripped apart, leading to the formation of a tiny planetary satellite, as proposed by the angular momentum conservation theory. Another method of satellite formation is condensation theory, also known as the co-accretion theory. When massive gas giant planets like Saturn or Jupiter are formed, a lot of rocky mass is also left as a remnant. This remnant mass too can come under influence of their self-gravity, stick together and finally coalesce, leading to satellite formation. Similarly, satellites can also be formed during the early stages of the solar system's formation, when excess gas and dust come together under the influence of their gravity, creating a tiny planetary satellite. Necessary conditions for satellites to remain stable. Satellites revolve around their parent planet in fixed circular orbits, which can be determined using the energy equation in Newton's laws of gravitation. Description of Mercury plus why doesn't Mercury have satellites? Mercury is the smallest planet in our solar system, only slightly larger than our moon. It is also the closest planet to the sun. It is named after the Roman god Mercury, the swift messenger of gods, taking a mere 88 Earth days to complete one revolution around the sun. It also claims the title of the fastest revolving planet in our solar system. However, due to its closeness to the sun, Mercury could not sustain a satellite in stable orbit around it. The sun's gravitational force is so strong in this region that any satellite orbiting Mercury would be engulfed by the sun in mere hours. So did Mercury ever have a moon during any particular time? Well, if it ever had one, the consequence would still be the same. The immense gravitational pull of the sun around Mercury would make the orbit of its satellite highly unstable, gradually pulling the satellite towards the sun and finally engulfing and hence destroying it. Mercury's small size compared to the sun would make it practically impossible for it to create a gravitational field large enough to hold its moon in a fixed orbit around it. Hence, out of all the planets, having a satellite to orbit around it would be the most challenging task for Mercury. If we follow the capture theory, a satellite that did come around Mercury and be captured by its gravitational presence would eventually be drawn into a solar orbit, gradually being engulfed by it. Taking the distance factor into account, if a satellite is too far from Mercury, it won't possess a stable orbit around it. Conversely, if it is close to Mercury, it may crash into it or may crash into the Sun. The final results will always be the same for Mercury. Hence, sealed by fate, Mercury continues to revolve around the Sun alone without a companion. Well, of course, we're always there for you, Mercury. Description of Venus, plus why doesn't Venus have satellites? So does the same reason stand true for Venus too? Is Venus too influenced by the huge gravitational force of the sun? Named after the Roman goddess of love, Venus is the second planet from our sun and the third brightest object in the night sky. It also claims the title of the hottest planet in our solar system. Venus is one of the rarest cases among all of the planets itself. The reason why Venus does not have a natural satellite in orbit around it is that no cosmic remnant managed to make it to the belt where the gravitational pulls of Venus and the Sun were balanced. Venus may have had a moon too at some point, but unlike the Earth, Venus was closer to the Sun, causing the moon to leave its original orbit around the planet and wander elsewhere. Taking its proximity to the Sun, it would be extremely rare for Venus to have a moon around it, such that the orbit of the satellite was the exact place of gravitational neutrality between Venus and the Sun, all thanks to this extra slim band. Hence, the Sun greatly influences the chance of Venus having a satellite in orbit around it. How did the Earth sustain having satellites? Even our Earth was lucky enough to have a satellite. Several factors were responsible for the survival of our moon. The presence of Jupiter was the most important of all. If it wasn't for Jupiter, our moon too would have been dragged towards an orbit around the sun and slowly be destroyed by it. The sun's presence near the Earth is still strong enough to cause tides as high as a building. However, the sun's presence gradually weakens as we go away from Venus. The moon is Earth's only natural satellite. It is thought to have formed about 4.5 billion years ago, not long after Earth itself. As we discussed earlier in this video, there are several theories about how the moon came to be, but the most widely accepted one is that a Mars-sized body collided with Earth, causing part of our planet's mantle to be hurled into space. This material then coalesced to form the moon. How did the Earth manage to keep its satellite? The pull of gravity between the two bodies meant that the newborn moon was drawn into orbit around the Earth. Although our planet has changed a great deal since then, the moon has remained relatively unchanged. It is thought that the moon's orbit has become gradually wider over time, but it will continue to circle Earth for many billions of years to come. Thanks to the stability provided by the moon, life on Earth has been able to flourish and evolve. Without our loyal satellite, things would be very different indeed. Whatever the reasons may be, we still wouldn't ever be able to confirm the real reasons behind the absence of moons for the first two planets. Is there still a possibility for Mercury or Venus to have moons? And if it is possible, then how? What if a large asteroid collided with either of them in the present time? Will it get a satellite then, as the Earth got? The universe is vast. We humans are just mere accidental happenings with a sense of judgment. There is a famous saying, judging the happiness of our universe based on mere notable facts would just be like examining a teaspoon of ocean water and commenting on the existence of sharks and other humongous creatures lurking in the sea. Just saying. For further updates, keep following us and do like and subscribe to our channel. It motivates us to further release more interesting topics like this. If you feel like any other topic confuses you, do comment to help us know about it.